I'd like to welcome everyone to today's last session of the Council on Foreign Relations Stephen C. Friedheim Symposium on Global Economics. We have a panel here today that clearly needs no introduction with Chairman Bernanke, Secretary Paulson, and Secretary Geithner, and I'm Ruth Porat, the Chief Financial Officer of Alphabet and Google. So the goal of our discussion here today is really to cover the arc of the crisis. What we want to do is talk about the choices made to address the biggest problems they confronted, to assess their choices, and then to look at the risks and the tools that are available today. And this rock star trio presided over a time when there were no good options. As we discussed back at the time, they were consistently choosing between least worst options. And I firmly believe that the United States and the world economies would have been in a much worse place without their leadership and the decisions that they made. But now, here we are 10 years later on their reunion tour. And so they are asked, and you do get to consider, what if they had done something else, and what do they regret? We're going to focus on that and also the lessons so that their successors can do as much as possible to both prevent the next crisis and get us through it as effectively as possible. Presiders typically now go through bios, but instead I suggest that once we're done, in the improbable event that members still need to check the bios, please go to Google, click away. And we're then going to leave time for questions. So I want to start with a rapid-fire question for the three of you. Kind of an obvious one. What was the most terrifying moment of the crisis and why? So why don't we just go right down the row here?
Well, there were plenty of terrifying moments for me, but I'll focus today on, you know, when the moment I learned that the House was voting down the TARP the first time, because it is, and there was sort of a mix of devastation and terror, but to go to Congress and to say that the administration is powerless to prevent a financial meltdown and avoid an economic catastrophe unless you act, you know, that's an untenable position to be in. It's a difficult position to be in. And when they vote it down, you know, you're exposing your vulnerability to the whole world. So immediately we scrambled and we were too busy to be terrified. But I still remember that night waking up in the middle of night and saying, wow, you know, if we don't get what we need from Congress, how are we ever going to put this thing together? And that's when I was looking at food lines and massive unemployment and so on.
We'll come back to that. Tim, your worst moment.
Man.
A lot of choices there.
Yeah. Rich menu.
Yeah. I think the hardest thing were in those weeks, I would say BC, before Capitol, before TARP, when I think we thought the thing was like, at that point, gone way beyond the strength of the tools we had to address at that point. You know, the Fed at that point was like way beyond the traditional frontiers of the use of the lender of last resort authority. It was not working. It was not enough. And that was scary. And then, you know, when the, you know, President Obama was, you know, started getting ready to take office, at that point, you know, we were looking at an economy that was still, you know, falling off the cliff, shrinking the annual rate about, you know, 8% of GDP in real terms. And there was this deep perception then, despite all the force of the actions that had been put in place in the fall, you know, despite, you know, backstopping trillions and trillions of dollars of liabilities in the financial system in the US and globally, all the capital injections, you know, there was this deep conviction in early January that the system was insolvent, would need another, you know, trillion or more of capital. And sort of trying to decide then what would work, what might be enough, what mix of things would solve it. That was hard too. But there were other moments, I'm sure.
And then your biggest nightmare moment.
AIG Day, day after Lehman's failure, President Bush sent Hank and me down to explain to Congress about the $85 billion loan. And we met with a select group of the heads of the both parties and the banking committees and so on. And we explained, you know, why we had to do this, why it was essential. You know, will it work? We think so. Will you get your money back? We certainly hope so. at the end of this discussion, though, Harry Reid, who was the majority leader at that time, looked at Hank and me and he said, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Secretary, I want to thank you for coming over here and explaining this to us. It's been very helpful. He said, but I want you to understand one thing. Nothing you've heard here tonight constitutes congressional approval for what you're about to do. This is your call and your responsibility. So like Hank, you know, it was pretty evident early on that the political support for this was not going to be particularly overwhelming, and it was a very lonely feeling.
All right, let's dive into a couple of the events. Let's start with you, Hank, with Fannie and Freddie. So I remember back in those days staring at a $5 trillion balance sheet, and you were laser focused on the risk to the economy from the fragility of the two housing entities. And you frequently said that you believe conservatorship of Fannie and Freddie not only averted a disaster, but did more to mitigate the reduction in housing prices and the number of foreclosures, and therefore helped people across the country than any other event. And I think that's not well understood. So can you help us better understand why you believe so firmly it helped homeowners?
Ruth, first of all, thank you. And, as you said, you know, this was a huge entities, and if they had imploded, you know, it would have been economic Armageddon, and it was really important to stabilize them before Lehman went down. But to get to your question, the way I think about it is this. The bursting of the housing bubble was really the match that it lit the fuse here that started the crisis and led to big, reductions in prices of housing, which was devastating to many Americans, and that was a big cause of foreclosure. Now, before we nationalized Fannie and Freddie and put the credit of the United States government behind them, they were insuring about half of all mortgages, maybe a little bit less than that. But after we did that, they were, for all practical purposes, the only source of mortgage funding during the crisis. So I can't prove a counterfactual, but just imagine, without mortgage funding, how much farther down housing prices would have dropped and how many more foreclosures they might have been. So again, I think this was important in two ways. It was essential to stabilize the financial system, but it also, I think, made a big impact in terms of dampening what was a very, very bad situation, but could have been much worse.
All right, talking about much worse, let's go to Lehman, Tim. There was a lot of discussion around Lehman weekend about moral hazard. Felt like any corner you turned in New York, you heard moral hazard concerns. And there was this notion that the government needed to draw a line somewhere so that others didn't feel like, you know, heads I win, tails you're there. But after the carnage from Lehman, the debate began. Was failure of Lehman a choice that the three of you made? Or was it, as you've each explained, the result of the fact that you didn't have legal authority? And I think the understanding around this was complicated by the fact that Lehman bankruptcy was September 15th, and just a short week later, Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley became bank holding companies.
AIG was the next day.
Then AIG was, yes, yeah. AIG yeah. was right after that.
I'm not pointing to Ben, I'm just saying.
Well, I want to get to yeah. We're going to get to AIG, so don't worry about that one.
Everybody else does.
But I was sticking with the bank holding company theme rather than going off to insurers, which we will get to. So what changed? Why not Lehman? Why Morgan Stanley, Goldman Sachs?
I think you can go back to March, because it's important to think back to that moment when Bear Stearns was at the edge of the cliff, and we were trying to figure out, could the system withstand the failure of Bear Stearns at that moment? Or do we have the means to offset that damage by lending more freely to the investment bank community? And we made a judgment then, which I think was the right judgment, that the failure would be terribly damaging, and that we should try to figure out how to prevent it. But we also decided that in the case of a weak failing investment bank like Bear Stearns, that our only option was to try to find a willing buyer large enough to effectively guarantee the obligations of that firm, prevent default. And in that context, we were able to find a willing buyer and assist that by taking some of the risk off the balance sheet using the Fed's ability to lend against collateral. We had the same presumption going into that weekend. You know, that weekend, Merrill Lynch and Lehman and AIG were all at the edge of the cliff. And we worked very hard to try to prevent the failure of all three of them. In the Merrill case, we were successful finding a willing buyer. In the Lehman case, we weren't. Why was that? That was because Lehman was perceived to be much weaker and was much larger, more complicated than Bear, and the system was much more fragile. So the universe of willing buyers was very limited then. In the end, we had one potential buyer, and that buyer, Barclays, the British, wouldn't let them go ahead. They thought Barclays was effectively too weak to absorb the risks. So that left us with no option to lend in that context. That was our basic judgment. We thought it would be bad. It was worse than we thought, but we were pretty sure it would be bad because this was so fragile. Bad enough worth trying to avert it, but not something in the end we had the ability to do. You're right that, I don't know how, you said a week later or 2 weeks later, we figured out a way to buy a little more time with Goldman and Morgan Stanley. Goldman and Morgan Stanley that weekend were able to go raise a pretty substantial amount of private capital, something Lehman had tried all summer to do and failed to do. They were able to raise some strategic capital, pretty substantial scale. And in that context, we were comfortable making them bank holding companies. But the bank holding company designation didn't buy them additional borrowing authority from the Fed. It created a little bit of pixie dust halo effect, but that was fleeting. And it's worth remembering that the time that bought was very limited, and conditions around both of them eroded. Again, a symptom of how bad the underlying storm was.
All right, so on to the third nightmare, AIG. Moral hazard clearly on your mind with respect to AIG. You said that you were reluctant to lend to AIG because you didn't want every non-bank to think it had a backstop. So moving, you know, out of the pure banks. Take us through your assessment of the risk if you did not act as you did. What do you think? I appreciate we don't have the counterfactual, but I remember so much at the time the concern was it going across the country and hitting individuals and small businesses. Yeah.
We were focusing on the investment banks, and AIG was a little bit, at least under my radar, you know, in the summer, although we had staff watching it and paying attention to it. And when the first possibility came up, you know, they were talking about acquisition, you know, various kinds of deals. When the possibility came up that we might lend to them, my first reaction was, oh my God, this is really extending, you know, the Fed is supposed to lend to commercial banks. We had already extended this to investment banks, so this would be yet another step to insurance companies. My initial reaction was, this is something we shouldn't do unless absolutely necessary. But then I fairly quickly, you know, over the same weekend that I was on the phone, and it was a tough weekend, I was, you know, talking to Tim and Hank about Lehman and trying to prepare for the FOMC meeting on Tuesday, and there's a lot going on, and then AIG. But as we got more information about it, I mean, it seemed to be a pretty clear call that we needed to do something on two dimensions. First was AIG, as I described it once, was a hedge fund on top of an insurance company. So it was like a mini investment bank that was insuring the credit of a lot of major financial institutions around the world. It had a very, very long position on RMBS, basically, both through securities lending and through its insurance of other firms. So its failure would have immediately created uncertainty about a lot of other firms. It would have created a lot of fire sales. It would have created just an enormous amount of stress, probably equivalent to another Lehman just from that dimension. Then on top of that, it was, of course, the world's largest insurance company. And so we had the possibility that this whole thing was going to leak into a whole new dimension. For example, if insurance companies fail, there's complicated state-level arrangements whereby other insurance companies have to make good. And so that would actually raise concerns about existing policies, about other insurance companies. It was horrible to contemplate, frankly. The reason we were able to act there, and I want to reiterate what Tim said, which is that it was a question of viability and feasibility. The reason that AIG was a feasible project for us was that even though there was no way, if the hedge fund on top of the financial products division had been by itself, we would have been sunk. But it had, you know, all these insurance subsidiaries, which were global and were profitable, and they could stand as collateral for a loan to address the liquidity problem. So we did have a means to do that, and that's, you know, even so, I have to say that people say we didn't put tough terms on the recipients. Tim really nailed them pretty hard, you know, with 80% equity ownership and a whole bunch of other 11% interest rate and whole kinds of very tough conditions. And I was actually pretty concerned that they would, you know, just say, well, we'll just rather go with default because it was such a tough situation. But they did accept, and we were able to, you know, it took a lot more effort, you know, many rounds to keep the company stable. It was the biggest headache we had, I think, during the crisis. But we did have the means to stabilize it because we had the collateral against which the Fed can make a loan.
And so the list of horribles continues. Let's go to TARP, where you started. So the TARP bank capital program put capital into over 700 banks. The money all came back with actually a nice profit for the U.S. government and did prevent the collapse of the system. Why was this so successful and so terribly unpopular at the same time? What were people missing?
Okay, Ruth, I'm going to answer that, but I should have. When you mentioned Fannie or Freddie, I wanted to say something because I remember when we were in the depth of dealing with that, calling John Mack, who was the CEO of Morgan Stanley, and asking for two of the very best advisors possible. And we weren't able to pay a fee or indemnify. And we got Ruth and Bob Scully, and boy, did they make a difference. So thank you for that. Now,
I think we got a dollar.
What?
I think we got a dollar.
You may have got a dollar. It was the indemnification.
That was a problem.
No one else was going to step up without indemnification. And boy, did you all come through.
Thank you.
You're right. So, you know, TARP, you know, the money came back with a profit, but the important thing was we were able to get out and stabilize, recapitalize the financial system with lightning speed, put money into 700 banks, and avoid a meltdown. But it's clear why it was so unpopular, because we did not have more compensation restrictions, and putting capital into banks or into any private enterprise, government taxpayer money, is a red line in the United States of America. Doing that is very unpopular. You know, we were perceived as, you know, helping the arsonists. Now, why did we not place compensation restrictions? I think that's really important. We were doing something that had never before been done. We wanted to induce many, many banks, even healthy banks, to take capital because the system was so fragile. The crisis could spread very quickly from weaker banks, relatively weaker banks, to relatively stronger banks. And we didn't want that to happen. And we had no ability to force banks to take capital. On top of that, during a crisis, no bank wants to raise their hand and say, hey, I volunteer to take capital, because they'll be toast. That's a sign of vulnerability. There's a big stigma to that. So, and we knew we were going to put restrictions on CEO compensation. So if we'd gone a step further and said, we want to control your overall compensation, that would smack of nationalism. The program wouldn't have worked. So what happened was we went out with lightning speed. We did something that was very non-traditional, and it worked. The Europeans went the traditional route. You know, they treated their banks like we treated Fannie or Freddie or AIG, and they were going to nationalize them. So the only banks that took capital were those that were about to fail or failed. And, you know, their system was undercapitalized for a long time. And I think we reaped the benefits, but our programs were unpopular. What we did was objectionable to us and, you know, objectionable to the Americans, but it was the best of the alternatives we were looking at.
Oh, you've each said that, made that point for each one of these very tough choices, which goes right to the point. A lot of worst choice, what's the least worst option? But to that point, that takes us right to, I want to switch gears and now start getting a bit of self-assessment here. And the big topic, of course, is populism. And, you know, we've heard the thesis, banks were bailed out, individuals weren't. There's a direct line from actions that were taken or not taken to the populist wave that we're seeing here and actually, you know, around the world. So can you give us just your assessment here of all the actions taken to stabilize the system? Did they contribute to populism? How do we put this question about populism in context? For you, Ben, yes. The easy one.
There's no doubt that a financial crisis is going to worsen populism. We saw it in the 30s. You know, there's evidence for that. And I And on top of that, we had a deep recession. Many people suffered, foreclosures. So I please don't, you know, think in any way that I'm denying that that was a factor. That being said, I think that some of the recent commentary, which says this all we're seeing in the political world today traces back to the crisis, I think that's way overstated. Take the United States in particular. You know, going back to the 1970s, early 80s, people have been telling pollsters that, you know, by margins of 3-1, that the country's, quote, going in the wrong direction. There's been a lot of concern about inequality, a lack of social mobility. And I think that the underlying theme there has been mostly a reaction and resistance to globalization. So what does Donald Trump talk about? He doesn't talk about shutting down banks, or he talks about doing a number on Dodd-Frank so banks can be more, you know, can make more profits. What he talks about instead is immigration, trade. Mm-hmm. Those, I think the connection is there is also tenuous, but I think where a lot of people are, particularly those who have cultural concerns, are saying, you know, globalization has not paid off, and we've not seen, particularly at the middle of the income distribution, we've not seen the benefits over the last 3 or 4 decades. I think that is the most important factor, but, you know, I don't want to deny that the crisis didn't help, and certainly the fact that a lot of people either lost their homes or lost their jobs, obviously that's going to make people less satisfied. And, you know, again, the things that Hank was talking about, the fact that we chose to sort of try to keep the system alive rather than let it die and then resuscitate it, that put constraints on how we responded, and no doubt that also affected the attitudes.
And obviously all of this was happening in a very short run-up to election. So Hank passed the baton to you, Tim, on Fannie Freddie. Sticking with this theme of populism, in retrospect, do you think more could have been done for homeowners? How do you think policies potentially should have been addressed differently, if at all?
Just to be honest about this, things we try to do on the housing front to reduce the scale of foreclosures were late and slow, and they were just not large enough to mitigate a lot of the damage. They were effective in slowing the rate of growth in foreclosures and capping them, and, you know, we did help millions of people stay in their homes and refinance at lower rates. And those actions were helpful. They added to the power of what conservatorship did to keep the mortgage market functioning and what the Fed did to keep mortgage rates low. And that helped put a floor under house prices and was a critical factor in limiting even worse recession. But the modification programs were, you know, they were late and slow, and lots of reasons for that. I would say probably the principal one was that we felt we had to work through the existing servicing infrastructure, which was, you know, was just terribly inadequate. And there were some pretty bad incentives in the complexity of the mortgage securitization market that made it hard to modify when it obviously was sensible. And we, you know, the things we did that worked in the end were very reached a lot of people. Just to be honest, they came late. Learning was slow, and that was damaging. It's not quite fair to say, although it is the popular perception, that the scale of the things we did for the financial system were larger, economically more meaningful than what we did for the average person. Just in terms of even simple math, of course, it's not just that the financial programs earned a very substantial positive direct financial return to the taxpayer. You know, people thought we would lose trillions of dollars on that, and they earned a very substantial positive return. But the scale of the tax cuts, direct transfers, benefits that went through the broader fiscal programs, housing programs, were much larger in dollars spent ultimately in that context. But you know, that gets lost. That got very much lost, understandably, in the debate where to break a panic, to prevent the risk of another Great Depression, we had to keep the system functioning. You know, we just didn't have the option. You know, panics are different from all of our financial crises. You don't have the option in a panic of deciding you're going to save depositors and not banks and bankers. No plausible strategy that rests on that, you know, typical strategy in a crisis. And I'm not sure it is possible to reconcile the fundamental tension between what's necessary to break a panic or save a country from a panic, and what is politically attractive, feasible in the moment. And I think one reason why financial crises are so terrible is most countries try to get the politics right before they try to get the strategy right. And that usually leads people to be way late behind the curve, too worried about moral hazard and fairness things, and they let the system burn, and that's why you get mass unemployment in recessions, depressions after most financial crises.
Yeah, I've often quoted Hank, who I remember in the depths of the crisis said, you have to have the will and the means, and too often by the time you have the will, you no longer have the means. And we just keep reliving that over and over again. When you think about some of the hard lessons, each of you has said one of the toughest was communication, and that's one of your biggest regrets, that it was just so hard to make clear to the American public how absolutely imperative this was in the limited choice set and how you were looking to really protect Americans across the country. What would you advise whoever is in your seats when that next crisis comes to do differently to be able to better communicate, land those messages? Anyone, if you want to start, Hank.
That's a hard one, because I was really tough on myself after leaving. I said I should have communicated better. And with hindsight, I look at it and I say, wait a minute. You know, we couldn't break the back of this panic without going to the source, which was Wall Street. So we had the right policy choice, number one. Number two, we all erred on the side of stability. You know, over telling the public what they wanted to hear. But if we talked about how dire the situation was and our lack of authorities, you know, it would have been easier to have people understand why what we did wasn't so as unfair as it looked, right? But we didn't want to spook the markets. And then lastly, at the end of the day, I look at it and say, wait a minute, you know, how do you sell these really objectionable, terrible things we did and sell them because they were better than the alternative and they were necessary? And so what the public sees is the hardship that resulted from the crisis. They don't see the disaster that might have happened, so you're never going to get credit for that. So I look at it now, and I say, wait a minute. You know, anybody that's heard me read a public speech knows that's sort of a painful thing, and I'm not a great orator. I happen to think I did pretty well on one-on-one and negotiating with Congress and so on, and in that kind of communication. But Barack Obama is, you know, and I don't think he sold it really well either. I think it's that's hard medicine to sell.
Tim, do you want to add to that?
Don't have a crisis while you're in office.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fantastic advice.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So regrets analysis. What else other than communication, if you could turn back the clock? I mean, the benefit of this 10-year tour is advising that next generation whenever they may come. What else would you look at and say, wish I had either not done it or done something differently? Why don't we hunt it on the last one?
I'll do three big mistakes. First is we let the financial system way outgrow its protections. It took decades. But, you know, on the eve of the crisis, the banks were like less than 40% of the relevant part of the financial system. The rest was operated outside the protections we put in place in the Great Depression. That took a long time to happen. Risk migrated outside the system. But that created a very fragile system, very dangerous system, a system much harder to stabilize than a typical bank-dominated system. Second is we went into the crisis with very weak emergency tools for dealing with a panic. You know, Hank had to go to Congress twice to get authority that was existentially important. But, you know, typically you're not going to find the political will to do that until the thing is way past the point of no return, so damaging that people can really feel at that point. It's going to be hard to avoid avoid the damage. And I would say more generally, after the initial wave of policy force and fiscal stimulus and all the monetary policy drama from the Fed, the U.S. lost the will to sustain the fiscal support for a weak economy too early. And we made the classic mistake of putting the brakes on a little early than would have been ideal. So those are three. But those capture a lot of other things.
And Ben, your regrets?
Well, you know, I feel like once we sort of understood the situation, we were pretty aggressive and we corrected mistakes pretty quickly and so on. I wish that I had somehow had a better view of the situation well in advance of the crisis. Given how slowly our government works, et cetera, I'm not sure that would have meant we could have prevented it, but we probably could have at least explained it better and gotten ahead on some things a little bit. And so I think that was something we didn't fully understand how these various factors. I mean, we knew that. I mean, people say you didn't know there was a housing bubble. We knew there was a housing bubble, but we didn't understand how it was going to translate into a broad-based panic that was going to bring down the even non-mortgage credit, as we were to see. So I think it was that not fully understanding the picture well enough early enough that was difficult. And
hold on for one second.
Yeah.
If you were sitting there today, how much greater clarity and visibility do you think you have?
Of what happened 10 years ago?
No, sitting there today,
oh, that's the
same
problem.
Level of visibility. So are the tools better? Is the data better?
Sure. It is better. It's better. I mean, Nellie Lang, who was just nominated by the president to be on the board, when I was there, I made her the first director of a whole new division at the Fed called Division of Financial Stability, which does enormous amounts of monitoring and analysis, things that just didn't happen, before then. So we've got a lot more visibility, a lot more effort, a lot more resources put into the systemic stuff. But I mean, another thing we learned was, though, that you can never be sure, right? So you need to also make sure the system is strong, and I'm sure we'll talk about that. But let me just say also in the communication, I didn't say anything about that. I just, I go back and forth on that myself. I mean, I tried to do some things on communication. I went on 60 Minutes a couple of times, and I did my best there. And so sometimes I feel like I should have done more, and I'm sure that at the time I didn't fully appreciate, how much reaction there was going to be. On the other hand, you look around the world, and can you point to a country where this problem was solved? It's not obvious that, that anybody has really figured out how to communicate this type of thing, and it's unfortunately, it is, by the way, I think a good reason to try to have the tools and the structure in place in advance and talk through in advance rather than have to do it, on the fly.
Can I just say one thing on this, Ruth? We all say this, but I think it's good to go back and just remember, we didn't have good answers for what we were going to do next, what was going to be necessary, because we were feeling our way. And although it's easy to say now that if we'd had the time to go out and give a daily press conference, so that people had a better feel for the choices we were making, that would have been reassuring, confidence-inspiring, would have broadened the political base for it. I don't know. I mean, I'm not sure. I just remember what I really felt at that moment. And apart from being consumed by trying to figure out what next, what might work, what could we do, it's just important to remember how much uncertainty surrounded really everything. And that lasted for 6 months. It wasn't like a fleeting thing. Maybe 9 months.
Yeah. And Tim, to add to that, just to put an exclamation point on it, we did not have the authorities we needed. We knew we didn't have them. We'd actually consulted with Barney Frank and with others. We knew we couldn't get them unless the And so we were doing things with duct tape and bailing wire. I mean, we were improvising with the authorities we had until the luck finally ran out. And so I think that's part of the issue.
For me, that was one of the most profound things, watching you constantly innovating, turning. If something didn't work, you didn't stop. You tried something else. And in that recent New York Times editorial that the three of you wrote, you made the comment that Congress has taken away some of the tools that were so critical to you during the 2008 panic, and it's time to bring them back. So if you could actually execute on that, what are in particular the most important tools that were taken away that you think we all need to give back to those who are in your seats?
Well, so I want to also emphasize we have some tools and the system is in better shape. But as I look at it, I say one of the scariest moments for me was when the money market funds began to implode. And when we heard from five or six of the big complexes that they're being hit with withdrawals, at the same time I'm hearing from major AAA industrial companies could not sell their commercial paper, and which they were relying on for short-term funding. So I'm looking at it and saying, wow, if they have to start cutting back and not paying their suppliers, this is going to move very quickly from Wall Street to Main Street, because it'll move very quickly to the smaller companies who'll be laying off workers. And so what do? We use the Exchange Stabilization Fund at Treasury to guarantee the money markets. Well, when Congress gave us, you know, the TARP, they also wrote in the law, never again use the Exchange Stabilization Fund, okay? So those that come after us won't have that again. That I think one of the most powerful things that gets less attention that was done was the FDIC using a very broad, expansive interpretation, you know, of their authority to guarantee the liabilities of bank holding companies and banks to issue new debt. That was very, very powerful and did a lot to help us break the back of this thing. Well, Dodd-Frank, Congress took that away. So there's two. I think that Ben and Tim have explained how the Fed used their emergency lending powers twice to avert disaster. First with Bear Stearns, which I think we dodged a huge bullet, because if they'd gone down before we'd stabilized Fannie or Freddie, Lehman would have gone down, I think, almost immediately. It would have been a disaster. But so, and used the emergency lending for AIG. Now, that's been taken away on an individual company basis. You can do it on a systemic basis. Now, we do have the orderly liquidation authorities to wind down a failing non-bank. We wish we'd had that with Lehman. And, you know, I think that works during normal market conditions. And let's hope it works during a panic. I'm not sure it will work the way Congress intends it to work during a panic, because one of the things we learned is to break the back of a panic, it takes fiscal authorities, it takes government money. And of course, the intent of that is not to use government money, but maybe it could be used in a very creative way in the middle of a panic.
This is a critical question. I'd love to hear Ben or Tim, would you add to that list? What else would you think is needed to stabilize if we find ourselves?
Well, from the Fed's perspective, what the Fed does as lender of last resort is provide liquidity against collateral to firms that are illiquid but presumably still solvent. And there are two authorities, a discount window that goes to banks. There was 13.3, which is used on an emergency basis for non-banks. Both were damaged by the subsequent legislation. There are disclosure requirements now in the discount window, which make it more stigmatized and less useful, and restrictions put on 13.3. So if you ask me what my ideal world would be, it would be a world similar to most other countries, like Europe in particular, where any financial institution that takes short-term runnable deposits, whether it's commercial paper or repos or whatever it is, and uses that to finance credit, should be subject both to, you know, sort of bank-like supervision and have access to Fed lending. I think that broad extension would make a lot of sense and would get rid of this artificial distinction between banks and non-banks, which was actually one of the key elements in the crisis.
Okay, let's talk a bit about leadership decision-making in a crisis. Tim, let's start with you. What do you believe are the most important principles that should be followed when in a crisis, both for those in government and also we obviously have many corporate leaders here as well? What do you do in a crisis?
Well, I think in a financial crisis, you have to recognize, you know, there's just huge uncertainty about the outcomes, and you know, you're going to make one of two mistakes. Either you're going to be late and slow and do too little, or you're going to take the risk of doing too much, overdoing it. And in a crisis, you have to have the, you know, you don't really know what is the line, the margin between something that is going to get resolved with little trauma, but without the risk of a panic, and what tips over into panic. And you have to have the flexibility to, you know, escalate very quickly. That's one reason why it's so important to have more discretion available to the Treasury and the Fed to take risks the markets can't take in a panic. Because without that authority, you won't be able to act quickly enough to break a panic. So I think people talk about this lots of different ways. They talk about it as a risk management framework for thinking about policy. You have to think about the range of probabilities and what's the costs and the damage that might be caused by something you think is remote, unlikely, but still is possible. And in a crisis, you have to give a lot of weight to that worst case outcome and try to err on the side of doing as much as early as you can to reduce the probability of that outcome. That's a simple framework. But I think, you know, the most important thing is that people around you who trust each other enough to debate things and disagree and to try to work through the options. And one of the great benefits that we had, apart from having two presidents from different parties over a dangerous transition, willing to basically put country over party and short-term political interests, was that we had a lot of trust in each other and enough trust that we could disagree and we could challenge each other and keep pushing it, figure out, okay, if not that, would this work? And if not that, then what might work?
Really important line there, put country over party. And Hank, I'm going to turn back to you. Twice you got Congress to give Treasury unprecedented emergency powers, first Fannie Freddie, then in TARP. And it's probably the last time we've seen something that coming together, both parties, to do something that was so controversial and yet so critical. In the polarized world we have today, do you think you could get it done, or what would you advise whoever is in your seats to be able to have that kind of outcome as you did back then?
Well, there's a lot in that, but as Tim said, we were backed by really strong leaders. And when I came to Washington, it was a poisonous atmosphere. I mean, 40% in approval rating would look pretty, pretty good. I mean, President Bush was in the high 20s then. But he encouraged me to work with Democrats and Republicans. And we had a year before the crisis hit. The three of us got to know each other, work with each other. I had a chance to develop a relationship of trust with the president, which is essential. I had an opportunity to actually get things done with members of Congress, work with Democrats and Republicans, trade deals, stimulus deals, et cetera. And so there was a lot going on. And the fact that there was divided government made a difference, because the Democrats felt a really strong a responsibility to govern. And the crisis brings out, we saw, as I said, we saw the worst before the crisis, but, at the end, it brought out the best. So I'm not, there's a lot of dysfunction in Washington right now. I'm not denying it. And this country is terribly divided. And so but I don't want to ever say and bet against the United States of America and say that in a crisis we couldn't come together and do what was necessary, because the crisis brought people together quickly, and ultimately we saw the very best in our government. And I'm certainly never going to say that's, no matter how bad things look in Washington, that we couldn't do what was necessary.
I'm going to open it up to members for questions, but I'm going to do a one-word answer from each of you, because crises do have a horrible way of repeating themselves. What one risk are you most worried about out there that could be the catalyst for the next one? Ben, we're going to start with you, and then we'll be opening it up to the members.
Well, I'm worried about the deterioration. This is the Foreign Relations Center. I'm worried about the deterioration in international frameworks and institutions. That means next time, we didn't talk at all about foreign cooperation, but we had enormous amounts of cooperation with other countries, and it was very helpful.
Tim.
Yeah, I would say politics. If you want one word, politics.
I'd have to say the same.
Okay, on that note, we're going to open it up to members. I just need to remind everyone, this is on the record. Please wait for the microphone and speak directly into it. Stand and state your name, your affiliation, and please limit yourself to just one question. And we have one right up in the front here, and then we'll go to the back.
Thank you. Thank you. Mark Engelson, Vice Chairman, Joe Biden Foundation, speaking for myself, not for anybody else. Question for Secretary Paulson, because you already answered in the last 90 seconds all the questions that I had, with the exception of one. How important were each of the fact that Tim had been the head of the New York Fed before he became Secretary of the Treasury? How important was the continuity of the chairmanship at the Federal Reserve System? And how important was Warren Buffett's investment in Goldman Sachs?
Well, wow. So they, first of all were essential. And, that to me, the way the three of us worked together, the way our skill sets complemented each other. You know, Tim, it wasn't just that Tim had been president of the New York, was president of the New York Fed, that's important. But he had started as a career employee and worked his way up to be undersecretary of Treasury. That's just phenomenal at a young age, and had been through two financial crises at Treasury. So, I mean, he helped advise me all the way along in terms of where the levers were at Treasury. The fact that the continuity that went when he then became the Treasury Secretary for President Obama, and then, of course, Ben, just, you know, what can I say in terms of the courage that he had and you know, the fact that he had actually done his academic work on the Great Depression. So none of the three of us, you know, as Tim said, we debated, we discussed all sorts of things, but we never debated whether we should take the risk of having a systemically important institution go down, because we all knew that that was something a risk that we weren't going to take. Now, in terms of the Warren Buffett investment in Goldman Sachs, I'm going to go back to the question that Tim got asked on Lehman and the bank holding company. Warren Buffett publicly stated that the reason he had the confidence to make that investment was we were up there seeking the TARP. That I think the idea that the Fed could suddenly have declared Lehman a bank holding company and put lipstick on Lehman and this institution that the whole world thought was insolvent was suddenly going to be safe. The key was that they'd been trying to raise capital, and they couldn't raise capital. The fact that Goldman Sachs raised capital from Warren Buffett and all that entailed a cornerstone investment, or Morgan Stanley had raised money from Mitsubishi, that's what saved them. It wasn't calling them a bank holding company. The Fed declared them a bank holding company just as they were raising that capital.
Can I just clarify one thing, though, Hank, on this? I mean, again, not to cast aspersions on the strength of those two institutions at that point, but remember,
yeah,
it was only when, on Columbus Day weekend, the TARP to put capital into most of the banking system, and the FDIC agreed to guarantee the ability of bank holding companies to issue new debt, that you first saw a meaningful break in the panic, and even that eroded too over the following 3 months. So it's not, you weren't implying this, it's not quite right to look back at that period of time and say those capital injections by Warren Buffett and by the Japanese bank into Goldman and Morgan Stanley themselves with the bank holding company did more than buy a little bit of time. And that's not to take anything away from those institutions and their management then.
Yeah, I agree with that. And with Morgan Stanley, you know, I still had to write a letter to the Japanese, you know, finance minister to keep Morgan Stanley from, keep Mitsubishi from backing away from their capital commitment. So again, we were really on the brink. And we were at a point where if either one of those institutions had gone down, I don't think the system could have taken it. I think we would have had just a massive meltdown.
Take a question right up here in the front.
Jeff Laurenti, to actually add a foreign relations dimension. The G20 had its big debut within a few weeks of the meltdown and panic, and it was seen in, I think it was March of 2009, as having successfully coordinated some global response. What concretely was contributed by partners, both the traditional G7 developed countries and the new emerging countries that were added in with the G20, in terms of reflating the global economy? And what were they asking of the Obama administration to do that it wasn't already doing?
Well, I think the right way to think about the international cooperation was, you know, the Fed supplied dollars freely to the world's central banks on a massive scale and lent directly to European financials on a very large scale. That was very important. Ben helped coordinate a global interest rate cut by the major economies in October-ish of 2008, which was a very important signal. Hank and President Bush convened the first meeting of G20 leaders to send a cooperative signal about commitment to prevent the collapse of the global financial system. But then in March, early April, we helped orchestrate another powerful signal of coordinated fiscal or cooperative fiscal response, continued cooperation among central banks, and provided a huge dose of additional resources to the IMF and the World Bank so they could lend to the emerging economies that were very much caught up in the crisis. So it was the strength of that signal that added to the steps that we've taken as a country that helped start to turn sentiment.
The G7, let me just add to that, that there was an incredibly important meeting of the G7 in October of 2008 after Lehman, when we coordinated among ourselves in terms of the kinds of actions we were to take with respect to our own banking systems, and also made a joint commitment that we would avoid any further failures of systemic firms. So the G7, I think, was dominant during that period. The G20, there was a break-in period where people got to know each other, and so it took a while before the G20 took the leadership role, but over the next few years it did.
Right up here, and the woman right in front.
Thank you. Hi, Neely Gilbert from Matarin Capital. As you took the extraordinary steps that you had to stave off the worst of the financial crisis, there were many naysayers who worried about the potential for hyperinflation or a much weaker dollar as the Fed balance sheet expanded greatly, or for a fiscal crisis as the deficit expanded and the potential for a loss of faith in U.S. credit quality. If we had higher interest rates at that time, it would have been a disaster. How much did you worry about the potential for those negative outcomes, and what do you think those naysayers got wrong?
Well, we were quite confident that hyperinflation and all those things were not in the cards. We understood that the economics of a liquidity trap where interest rates are close to zero are quite different from sort of, wartime situations when you get the hyperinflations. So we were not concerned about that. We weren't concerned about the dollar. There were a lot of other concerns, I think, that were more minor that we tried to pay attention to. We tried to go, we were often accused of being reckless. We tried to be as cautious as we could, consistent with achieving what we needed for the economy, but also, in retrospect, we had a conference last week and the commentary on the monetary policy was they went too slowly, and because they were being too cautious about the things they didn't understand. So we went cautiously, but we were pretty confident that those risks of QE and so on were not really there. And I would, the media people here, I don't think the media did a very good job. They gave a lot of credence to people who were not really qualified to comment on these issues, but who were making these kinds of claims. And it hurt us. We got political pushback. We got a letter from Congress saying don't do QE2 because it's gonna cause hyperinflation. So it was a problem for us, but we obviously, the Fed is independent. We did what we thought was necessary.
On the fiscal side, quickly, we thought it was essential to have a very substantial dose of fiscal stimulus given the collapse in private demand at that point. And with the financial engine broken down, monetary policy could not carry the sole burden of reducing the severity of the recession. We thought that was very important and ultimately got several rounds of substantial stimulus, not enough to offset the collapse in private demand, but it was very important to it. We did make the judgment that should be, although sustained for as long as possible, should be temporary, and that we should work to get the deficit down to a sustainable level over a five-year period of time, which we ultimately did, although, as I said earlier, it happened a little too fast for comfort. We did that because we thought that the credibility of our capacity to provide a sustained support for the economy depended on the world believing we would bring our deficit back down to a more moderate level within a reasonable time frame. So we were not worried we were going to become Greece. We thought there was no alternative but a substantial temporary increase in borrowing. But we didn't think it was something you could justify doing indefinitely and had to show some measure of political will to get ourselves back to a deficit that would stabilize the debt burden at a relatively acceptable level.
The gentleman right up here in the middle.
Angela Lisboa, JP Morgan Chase. Secretary Paulson mentioned the importance of healthy banks accepting and participating in TARP to avoid the stigma, right, and heightening the panic. Do you worry next time healthy banks will refuse government support and stay away from shotgun weddings?
And the simple answer is yes, I do. Because what happened, it was fascinating and it was demoralizing to watch. Because we'd structured these equity infusions, they were going to be preferreds rather than common, non-voting. We agreed that everyone was going to take the capital. But it didn't take long for the press and the public to start talking about these being nationalizations, and then the stigma to set in. And there was a stigma, and you know, and you're from J.P. Morgan Chase. I would say Bear Stearns. We look at J.P. Morgan bought Bear Stearns and WaMu, and I think both of those acquisitions helped the country a great deal. J.P. Morgan made those acquisitions also because they thought they were in their best interest. But I don't think that they or Jamie Dimon expected to see the kinds of repercussions he saw. So, I think it will be harder during the next crisis to have policymakers do some of the things we did because they were so unpopular. It'll be harder to have Congress vote for something like that again. It'll be harder to get banks to take capital again. It'll be harder to get banks to step up, healthy banks, and make a risky acquisition in the middle of a crisis again. So all of that will be more difficult.
On that note, the last question goes to the woman a couple rows back behind our last questioner.
Good morning, Catherine Harrison from IBM. I wanted to ask, one of the key innovations that came out of the financial crisis has often been called Bitcoin and the rise of cryptocurrencies. Proponents of cryptocurrencies really focus on the benefits of decentralization and the ability to simply fork a network if a problem comes up. Given what all of you have lived through and described, decentralization would certainly not have been a strength. What advice would you have for those organizations who are in the process of building these new emerging economic models around governance and managing the crises that will inevitably come?
That's a question for Ben.
I think there's a lot of silliness around cryptocurrencies, a lot of bubbles, a lot of people who don't understand what they're about. So I would put that aside and just say, though, that there are a lot of interesting technological developments having to do with decentralized trading and so on, which are potentially quite interesting. And actually, you know, thinking about the medium term, one of the big challenges to the financial system is going to be technological innovation, because you're going to see all different ways in which banks are going to get disintermediated in various ways. They won't be able to do their normal functions because it'll be technological substitutes or specialty firms that, you know, do some of these different things. And so the question of how the regulatory system and how the Fed and so on will adapt to that is actually quite interesting. So short answer, not a big fan of cryptocurrencies, but I think there's some interesting technological developments, and we're probably going to see some massive changes in the financial system over the next 10 or 20 years.
And on that note, a sacrosanct tradition, as many of you know, is that we finish on time. Looking at Dr. Haas here, so we are on time. I want to thank our three speakers here today, not just for the rich insights, but also for your leadership during some of the most painful times. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.